Thank you. Good morning. Good morning. As you are coming on into our sanctuary, I invite you to come and find a seat and prepare your hearts for worship. And if you're going to continue to have some conversation out in our narthex area, I'll invite our ushers to please go ahead and close our sanctuary doors so that we can create our an environment of worship here. I came to seek Jesus today. Why are you here? Amen. Yeah. Yeah. We're standing on holy ground. So let's stand as we feel led and as you're able. And we're going to start out with, Lord, I lift your name on high. And I invite you to join us in singing. Reflection, and Luann's going to come and share and connect us with our scriptures today.
No, All right. I'm on. I'm live again. So, will you pray with me? I need to just get myself centered. It's been one of those days. So. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for bringing us all together. You know, today you've taught me that we're all oddballs, but you love us anyway. And as I share today, please let your spirit pour out in and through us, each of us. All of this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. So today's sermon series is Covenant Blessings. Cup of Blessing. Oh, I forgot my cup. Oh, well, pretend I'm holding a cup. It says Jesus loves you. Has a rainbow on it. I meant to bring it. Oh, well. So today we're going to hear those words of Jesus speaking to us as we remember the special time he spent with his disciples during the Last Supper. He shares the special celebration of life with us yet today. Each time we take communion, we remember Jesus. We remember his covenant with us now. Jesus shared his journey with them then and expects us to share the journey as we live today. God gives each of us the stories. I've been sharing different stories, parts of my life, the last few weeks. And today I'm just going to kind of try to hopefully give you a vision of what my cup of blessing is. So Jesus shared his journey. He wants us to share ours through our stories. And when I was asked to share during this sermon series about covenant blessings, I graciously accepted. I really did not know what I was going to share at the moment, but one thing that God put on my heart was it was going to be a personal journey. And I appreciate everyone who has listened to my reflections involving only a few chapters of my life story. It gave me a chance to share my cup of blessings, just like Jesus did with the disciples and does with us during communion. I believe God has given us all stories, which we should share with one another. Through sharing our experiences, we share how Jesus and God has worked through us. Sometimes our stories are kind of unbelievable. Yeah. But our lives have many chapters, and some of the chapters in my story are seemingly unbelievable, but are true. And if you read the whole story, you'd walk away wondering, why and how can this be? Kind of reminds of me of some thoughts I have when I read the Bible. Not sure about this, God. But my story is similar to those stories written in the Bible of those who lived before us. And I believe that your stories are probably pretty close, too, to share. But what about all the stories? Why do they happen? How can a person get through each trial of life? How can you look at your life and each situation and live and be joyous? The one name that rings a bell in my mind, in my heart, is Jesus. Jesus lived on this earth. And he lived a long time ago, probably lived a harder life than we do. But Jesus gave his life so that everyone could be joyous, even with trials of the world. And Jesus paid that cost for each of us to make choices in our lives. Jesus paid the cost with his life. But it didn't end there. And that's wonderful. Because he conquered death so that we may all have life beyond what we know and experience on this earth now. He lives and continually gives us grace, mercy, and love. I just need to ask, do you feel Jesus? Do you feel him? Because he's here. He's here in each one of us right now. And he knows your story. And he knows it well. And he lives each of our stories with us. We're not alone when we're living. Jesus is there, living it with us. And he wants us to reach out to one another and share our lives and to share our stories with one another. He wants us to reach out and share the love that he gives each of us. He wants everyone to feel the love he gives. So will you share your cup? Because my story is my cup of blessings. And every time something happens, it fills it a little bit more. Will you share your cup the way Jesus shares with us? So I chose to share my cup today with you. And I give thanks for the stories I have to share. And I give thanks to God for being alive in my life and having connections I have, which keeps me in the Spirit. Praise God that you're all here, and praise God for Jesus. Let's worship some more by singing.
Amen. Oh, definite cup of blessings having each and every one of you here as part of our family. Thank you, Luann. Let's continue our time of praise and worship as Luann invited us to do with singing. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
I want to see you. Jesus. Holy, 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 I want to see you. Holy, 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 I want to see you. Holy, 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 I want to see you.
That concludes our time of praise and worship. And so now it's time to get your pencils and paper out there so you can write down all the upcoming ministry opportunities and excitement that we have for us in the week ahead.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see everyone here. Thank you for joining us for worship this morning here at Grace. Leah and I have a few announcements this morning. Okay, so to start off, February 15th after worship will be an information session about the endowment. Please review the documents received by email or in your inbox. Let the ad hoc endowment committee know if you have any questions, and those questions can be referred to Shelley, Wanda, Dan Glant, Susan Robertson, or Reverend Sandy. And then on February 22nd, following worship, will be a potluck and special church conference to approve the permanent endowment.
Boy, that's an exciting journey. As a reminder, our garage sale or yard sale is June 5th and 6th. And so if there's anything that you'd like to donate to the yard sale, please think about putting all those together. One reminder is, unfortunately, we do not have a tremendous amount of storage here at Grace, and so we're asking that you gather them up and then bring them closer to the yard sale. So thank you.
Please sign up today or tomorrow for a place at the table, which is a Lenten study that starts Tuesday, February 17th at 6, and that is led by Vet and Reverend Sandy. Sign up in the Narthex today or tomorrow so the books can be ordered for that. Also, another Lenten study, 24 Hours That Changed the World by Adam Hamilton, is a study on Monday mornings at 9:30. That one is led by Gail Graves, and that starts February 16th. So two different ones. February 17th is a place at the table, and February 16th is 24 Hours That Changed the World.
And also a reminder that Grace is helping out with Cheyenne Day of Giving with our donations of clean underwear. And boy, let me tell you, this box looks pretty darn stuffed here, but I know we can stuff it a second time. And all of these donations are going to help Cheyenne Day of Giving.
Observe the beginning of the Lenten season on Wednesday, February 18th at 7 p.m. for Ash Wednesday service.
And we have a wonderful thank you note here, and I'm going to just read it to you. It's such a beautiful letter. It says, Grace United Methodist Church, Interfaith Family Support Services, would like to thank you for your continued support to our program. Your generosity is helping change the lives of families in need. Your recent donation is going to help us to help others become self-sufficient and are on the right path for their families. Thanks again for all that you do. And this comes from Lori and Melanie. So thank you very much for everything that this church is doing to help IFSS.
On Friday, February 20th, Giggles we'll be meeting at Ribbon Chop. If you could please sign up in the Narthex or email Wendy so you guys can join everybody for Giggles on February 20th.
So this is the last week, last time for this announcement. I was going to dance. I was going to sing. Yeah, shoot. Actually, I think y'all are probably saying thank you. But a reminder, on the 14th, there is a Valentine's Day last chance. All right, there you go. And so please get the tickets and join us for this wonderful event, whatever it will be. Some people have asked me to do some dancing, but unfortunately I will not be there that day. My daughter and I were going to be out of town. But also a reminder that the United Methodist Men will be meeting and having game night on March 14th, so think ahead as well.
This announcement is from Vet. She would like to thank the youth group for helping clean and organize the donation room for the playground ministry. Our youth are fantastic.
You betcha. And also, the Faith Day at the Rockies. That's coming up on July 26th. It's 2 o'clock, Rockies versus the Reds. What's really cool is Michael W. Smith will be the entertainer. If you've ever had an opportunity to hear Michael W. Smith, it's like a worship service through song. I tell you, it's amazing. So if there's a need for 25 people to be a group, and we get the group rate tickets, which is a reduced price of $24, but we need to know by February 18th. Please talk to Wanda about that.
All right, next up, we have birthdays and anniversaries. Juliana, do you want to do the birthday cake? Do you want to pass that around? If you have a birthday or anniversary this coming week, Juliana is going to be passing around the cake. And some people like to contribute $1 for every year you've been here on this earth, or $1 for every year you've been married. But any contribution is greatly appreciated. It does go to help those in the community. So if you could just raise your hand so Juliana can come by when you hear your name called, that'd be great. So for birthdays, we do have a belated birthday. Sorry we missed Jenny Barnes's birthday. So happy birthday. Hers was on the 6th.
And then we also have Kay Ellis on the 12th.
Glenda Owens on the 13th.
Lee Rotifer and Alex Mark on the 14th.
Happy birthday to all of you. And anniversaries on February 12th, Tim and Glenda Haley will celebrate 33 years.
That is something to celebrate, absolutely. We have a second anniversary, Michael and Ruth Dent on 21.
I wonder if you'd consider joining me on a
happy anniversary to all of those. And okay, so I guess that's, yes, we'll just continue on with our worship. Thank you.
Thank you.
Please stand if you are able for the call to worship. See, you're ready. Throughout biblical history, God has created covenants with his people. In God's covenant with Jesus, both God and Jesus were changed.
Let us commit to offering ourselves fully to God in response to God's great mercy and blessings.
All right, join us with I Come With Joy, number 617.
Please be seated, and I invite our children to come forward for children's time.
Okay, I need everybody to make a fist. Okay. Keep that in mind. We're going to come back to that later. Okay. How many of you, how do you think that babies show love? How do you think babies show love? How do you know? Exactly. How do you know that a baby loves you? It'll give you a hug. Okay, good. How else? They stay what? They stay in your house. Don't wander off. Okay. They give you fist bumps, just to give you fist bumps. Okay, yeah, good.
They do that,
yeah. Bring you toys, it's all good, yeah. How do you know that a toddler or somebody who's not in school yet, how do you know that they show you love? How do you know they love you?
They can say I love you.
They can sing, yeah, good. How else? They can cry on your shoulder. They can get hurt and they can come to you and go, ah, right? Okay. How do kids in school, like elementary school, show love? They can give you a hug. They can make you, draw you a picture, make some art. Good. They can say it. Yeah. Are you guys going to give Valentines out at school? Do they do that still?
Sometimes,
yeah. Okay. How do teenagers show love? They don't? They carry out the trash. What'd you say?
They do this.
They say thank you. What'd you say a minute ago, Josh? They play on the phone. Is that showing love? They can type you that they love you. They text you that they love you. They argue with you in a loving, respectful way. Okay. How do adults show love? They can give you a hug. They cook you food. They can buy you flowers. Somebody take notes quick.
They can tell you.
They can draw pictures. They can cheer for you.
Yay.
They go to Jared's. Love it. Where is Brian? I don't even think he's in here. Yeah. They can text you. Okay. When do you show love? Do you show love at home?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you show love at church?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you show love at school?
Yes.
How so?
Friends.
Yeah, you can laugh and hang out with your friends and show that you care for them. You can take care of them if they want to cry on your shoulder or they're sad. You can be with them. Yeah? Okay, go back to your fist. Remember your fist? This is how big your heart is inside your body. Yeah. Yeah. Look at who's
my
this?
My heart isn't very big.
It's about the same size as mine, actually. Just so you know. Yeah? Who's bigger? Yeah, mine's a little bit bigger. Yeah, mine's bigger. Yeah. Does that mean I can show more love than you? Because I have a bigger heart?
No.
No? Has anybody ever watched a YouTube video on a computer?
Yeah.
How big is it on your computer or on your phone or iPad or Nook?
It could be any kind of size.
Any kind of size, but how much goes beyond that? How many videos are there on YouTube?
Infinite.
Yeah, a lot.
There are infinite videos.
I read somewhere, it's like every 2 minutes, like, 48 hours or 2 weeks of YouTube videos are uploaded. That's insane. I have to find the actual. But this blew my mind. It was a lot. So even though your heart, and really, does your heart, this is just a symbol, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, your heart really doesn't look like this, and it doesn't look like the one you get on the Valentine card, right? No? It's a symbol. But anyway, it depends on how big your heart is. Look how much you can love all over the place, right? So it's like YouTube and video, only bigger. How does God show us our love, or love to us? Does God show us love? Yeah. How? Sends us a Valentine card? Flowers, and does God go to Jared's? You're alive. That's good. Yes. How else does God show love? With what? Beauty. Yeah. There's beautiful things all around us. Yeah.
Everything.
Everything. Yeah. Give you a roof, yeah? It's except for man-made things. That's a great statement, yeah. Does he show love by allowing people to make things to give to others? Yeah, yeah. So when we collect underwear, is that showing love?
Yeah.
Underwear equals love. I like it, yeah, yeah. So when we collect underwear, it's man-made underwear, and we, humankind, are giving our underwear, but we're showing love to others by providing for them. So I think that's good. What's a symbol? If this is a symbol of our heart, and our heart is huge, because we can do all sorts of great things, what's God's symbol to us, that he loves us? There's several. There's a lot.
Rainbow.
Rainbow. I love you. I'll take care of you always. Yep, good. What else?
Mm-hmm.
Life, yeah, what's a symbol? What's a symbol that we can look at that reminds us that God loves us? The sun, the heart. There's several all over the sanctuary. That's a good reminder.
We're here.
Yeah, the cross, thank you. Yeah, so is this a symbol of God's love? Like the heart is a symbol of how on Valentine's Day we show love to others. The communion table is also a symbol of how Christ sacrificed himself for us. All these symbols are a way to remind, and they're around us all the time, that sometimes we don't even remember to see them. Look at how long it took you guys to come up with cross. I know, that's silly, huh? Giggles. Yeah? So don't forget to look and see love and beauty and the gifts that God provides us all the time. And I know you probably get chocolate hearts and candy hearts and hearts of this and hearts of that on Valentine's Day, right? But there's all sorts of ways that people show love, and you got to remember, including this. Look, it's just the best. Is that the best? That's the best. All right, so remember that. God shows us love, and we need to show others love too. Thank you for coming up.
Don't make me leave. Bye-bye, Taylor. We'll see you later. Bye-bye. At this point in our worship, we have a great celebration. We have some new members that we're going to join into our church membership. So I'm going to invite the Rifes and Gail forward. Yeah. Yay, woo-hoo! You get to come all the way on the top. I know. I have to do a little bit of embarrassment, right? Like all the way up here. All the way. Very good. So we have joining into membership Fred and Jennifer Reif and Gail Stell. So tell me where your transferring your membership from?
From First Christian Church here in Cheyenne.
First Christian Church here in Cheyenne and?
Calvary Baptist.
Calvary Baptist. So what this means is that both Fred, Jennifer, and Gail are coming to us from non-United Methodist denominations. So that means there's an extra question that we ask as we enter them into membership here at Grace United Methodist Church. So I'm going to ask you a few questions. If you're not quite sure what to say, I'll give you like a hint.
Okay.
That'll be okay?
Good.
So as members of Christ's Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries?
I will.
Good. Good answers. And then this question receives you into membership here at Grace United Methodist Church. As members of this congregation of Grace United Methodist Church, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? All right. And then for your part, I need you to find your hymnal real quick. Turn to page 38. I should have had you do this before. Sorry about that. You're going to find your response down at the bottom of the page in the bold. So I'll start reading the introduction to that. Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. Page 38. And that's just our Methodist way of saying welcome. Let us say it. Welcome. Yeah. So in so many ways, it already feels like you've been a part of our family, and this just kind of makes it official on the books or whatever. So another official piece is your certificate of membership that I'm sure you will treasure and frame and put up in a prominent place in your house after I've thrown it on the floor, right? Yeah, for all can see as they enter. And then also the coveted golden dove pin that you can put on your name tag. And it signifies to all that you are members of Grace United Methodist Church. So welcome. Welcome. Welcome,
thank
Jennifer.
You.
And welcome, Fred.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. As we move into our time of prayer, wondering if there are any prayer cards. I didn't get any today. So as we look at our joys and concerns, our prayer lists that you see in the bulletin and on the screen, I only have one update, and that is that Juanita Pennington moved from the hospital to rehab yesterday. And that news was brought in person by Darlene Evans, who is back from her long 10 weeks away. And as Juanita's sister-in-law. So we continue to pray for Juanita and for all of those on our prayer list. During this prayer time, this prayer season, we have a prayer hymn. So we're going to sing You Are Mine, a verse and the refrain. And a couple of different times during our prayer time, we'll sing the refrain. So let us sing. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we hear the words to this song that say, get up, walk, and now live. We know that throughout our history of humanity, you have offered to us the gift of life. And sometimes we have embraced that gift as a people, and sometimes we have not. And yet we know that as people, either collective or individual, we have a choice. We can embrace, but it takes a little bit of action on our part. We know what it feels like to offer a hug to someone and for them to stand there with their arms just down by their sides and not returning the hug. That is similar to the action that you ask us to embrace life, to lift up our arms and use our muscles to embrace and squeeze. Holy God, you have called us into life, into new possibilities, into a vision of a world that is yet unimagined. And you ask us to lift up our arms and embrace. Just as Jesus told the paralytic, get up, walk, and live. And in those words, that paralytic man realized a whole new reality. And so can we. So as we hear your voice calling us into something new that we can help create, help us to be bold. Help us to step forward. Help us to raise our arms and embrace. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. Reading today is from Matthew 26, chapter 26, verses 27 through 29. Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you, my Father's kingdom." The word of God for the people of God.
Will you pray with me? Loving God, send your spirit upon us that as your scripture has been read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what it is you have to say to us this day. Amen. So yesterday, the boys and I, it was a beautiful day, so Jimbo went snowmobiling, of course, and the boys and I had to find something to do, and we just thought it was so beautiful, we were going to go down to Denver, we were going to go to the zoo. Little did I know it was free day at the zoo, and it was like, oh my, from I-70 all the way down to the zoo, Colorado Boulevard was packed, so we were like, ditch that idea. We ended up finding an outdoor mall, and we just kind of walked around, and then we met up with some friends, some of my clergy friends, and had some lunch and ice cream and that kind of stuff. So anyway, we're sitting there talking, and what I love about these clergy friends is that they love my boys probably more than they love me. I think they like them more than, so it's not just about, you know, adult talk. They totally are about the boys and what the boys are doing, and they love them so much. So anyway, so Emery's sitting there, and he's like, "Have you ever heard of string theory?" And they were like, "What?" And he's 11, right? And so he starts saying all this stuff about string theory, which I have done some research since yesterday afternoon about string theory. I'm not sure that it's quite right, but, you know, I mean, it's this idea that in his explanation, the way that Emery explained it, was that there's always these choices, right? And there are an infinite number of possibilities for those choices and where that might lead us. So, I mean, this morning, if you chose to drink orange juice as opposed to something else, that might create a whole spin-off on a new possibility, right? So string theory is very, very complex. It's all about physics. It is about these kind of strings of the universe, and there is really an ideas of multiverses. I mean, that there is like layering of universes. This is a real thing. It's a real thing, right? Who's anybody in physics here? Okay, because y'all are just like, what? What is going on? Okay, so anyway, I mean, like brilliant people like Stephen Hawking. I mean, he was really one that worked on this verse. On this kind of theory. It really is kind of some thought out there. But what was so funny was that we were sitting there listening to Emery explain string theory to us, and my friends were just like, "How old is he?" You know, just like this. What is he even talking about? Just this idea that this was way beyond us. But you think he's just doing games on these little iPads and tablets and things. He's like watching all these crazy videos. Some of them good, some of them not so good, but apparently he learned string theory in one of them. But so what I do know about string theory is that there really are these possibilities, almost an endless variety or potential for endless possibilities. Okay. That was kind of interesting. So we're in the middle of a sermon series, coming near the end, as we look at God's relationship with human beings through the formation of a covenant, right? So as we look at the way that God has been in relationship with God's people through the Bible, we see that in the beginning that God made a covenant with Noah. It was kind of a really elementary type covenant, should we say, that God realized that God did something that maybe God didn't really mean to, or really kind of learned something from that and decided that that God didn't want to do that anymore. So God said, okay, I won't do that anymore. Covenant, not going to do that anymore. Rainbow, right? That's my sign that I won't be doing this anymore. And then we looked at God's covenant with Abraham. who, and it was really a covenant with Abraham and Sarah, that was like, you're going to be fruitful and multiply. You're going to have this great, great nations. You're going to be the father and mother of nations and nations. And you're going to bless all peoples, and you're going to get this land, and yada, yada. And then we get this covenant with Jacob that is kind of a focusing of that same covenant with Abraham, but it's more. It's like, through you, I'm making my covenant. And he even calls Jacob from that point on Israel. I mean, he is like the symbol, the ambassador, the whatever, the, you know, kind of the model for all of Israel. And then last week we talked about the covenant with Moses. And then kind of the way that God started shifting God's covenant a little bit, realizing that in Moses, it was all around the Ten Commandments, right? And here in this covenant, here are the ways that you're going to act and behave, right? And then we heard that Jeremiah passage that said, actually, I'm going to start writing these things on people's hearts. So it goes from an outward expression of behavior and actions to something that really happens in here. Just some interesting shifts, I think. And if you ever take theology classes, or if you ever go to like a disciple Bible study or a Bible study that really wants you to think theologically, there are three main questions that you ask if you want to start thinking theologically. And any of you can do this, so you can all be theologians. Here is your lesson how. What is this scripture? You read some scripture. What does this scripture say about God? What does this scripture say about humanity? And what does this scripture say about the relationship between God and humanity? That's all theology is thinking about God, thinking about us as people, and thinking about the relationship between God and people. And I don't know if you're getting it or understanding it in the same way that I am, and it just in the sense that at the beginning, these covenants seem really like, here's what we're going to do, right? Oops, I didn't like that. I'm going to change it. And then kind of, oh, but we're going to change it again. And well, actually, we're going to change it again. And actually, we're going to change it again. And then what that says to me about God is that God is learning right along with people. That God also is changing because of God's relationship with humanity, with people. Because God is a relational God and wants to be in relationship and is just trying to figure out how best to do that. In Jeremiah last week, we heard the scripture pointing towards a new covenant. A new covenant. And as Christians, we believe that Jesus created, or God created, that new covenant in Jesus. So I was really interested this week. I was having some conversation with Vet. Last week, she wasn't here because she was at a practicum or a praxis or something like that through ILF. She's a student at ILF, as is also Leah. And she came back and kind of shared with me some of the information that she learned at this kind of intense, you know, Friday, Saturday, Sunday class that she took. And I thought it was really interesting. I really appreciated it because it came from seminary. And I feel like I'm so far from seminary, and it was just like, woo, I remember seminarians like talk about stuff that's really cool. So, of course, throughout the ages, different scholars, different theologians have had different models of the way that we understand God, the way that we understand God's relationship with people and relationship to the world. And so one of the things that Vet brought back and she shared with me was just several pages of different models, different ways that scholars and theologians and ordinary people have understood God. So one of the models was called eschatological suffering. This is why I love seminary, because you're like, what does that mean? So anyway, here's what it means. It would mean very basically about God, that God is all-powerful, all-knowing, and all-good. And that in this eschatological suffering model, that God and people enter into covenants with each other. So I thought, covenant? Oh my gosh, that's what made me start looking into all of this. And in those covenants, whether it's between people or whether it's between God and people, the covenants bring into being a new order of creation. So it's kind of like God is saying, here is my vision. Here's where I want us to be. We're not getting there. So can we agree together? Can we make this covenant together to get here? And so God makes covenants. And that seemed to make sense to me. So these covenants represent a new order or an envisioned future. Does that make sense? Then there was another one that I just really loved, because some of my theology classes were in process theology, and I love process theology. It is so intriguing to me because it actually brings in a little quantum physics. It actually brings in a little string theory, and it's really cool. So in the process theology model is called ambiguous suffering. And in this model, God's power is persuasive and relational. And that seems to make sense to me too, that God wants to be in relationship with God's people. And God is always calling us into new possibilities that are not even envisioned yet. And that in this calling forward to a new possibility, we become co-creators with God to create that new possibility. And those new possibilities, they're called novel, right? Like novelty. It's like something that's never happened before. It's like something new, something novel, something wonderful, and as yet unimagined. And I just kind of thought about that idea. I mean, this is process theology, that we're going along and there's always these moments of choice. And I'm not just talking about whether you're going to have orange juice for breakfast, okay? There are these moments of choice. And if you think about a line, and you come up to this moment of choice, this is not the only possibility. The possibilities are endless. If something changes here, look what can happen here. And it's novel, and it's wonderful, and it is new creation. And I thought of God. And I thought of all of these times that God has worked with God's people, trying to control behavior, trying to offer really, really good stuff so that God's people would say, okay, that's good enough. I'll do everything that you want to, God. And going along on this line and then saying, you know what? We don't have to keep going along this same line. In fact, at this moment, there are infinite possibilities if only we realize them. And together with Jesus, created the ultimate choice of new possibilities for a new future. And that all along the way, we continue to have these moments where God is calling us forth into something that is yet unimagined, but novel and wonderful. And that all along the way, we've got the choice. And do we choose to co-create with God new possibilities, new dreams, a new reality for us and for all of the world? And so I invite you today, as we come to this time of sacred meal, that you have a choice about what you want to drink this morning. Grape juice new possibilities, the bread of life, the cup of a new covenant. Join with me in our liturgy. Lift up your hearts and give thanks to God. Blessed are you, O God, who with your word and Holy Spirit created all things and called them good. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us. Through Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself sin and death and destroyed their power forever and ever. You raised from the dead this same Jesus who now reigns with you in glory and poured out upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took the bread, broke it, and gave thanks to you. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When Jesus was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to God, and shared it with his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of a new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this cup, we may know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood. Until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at your table forever. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. I invite our communion stewards to come forward.
Thank you.
invite you to please stand and join with us in our closing hymn. As you're standing, I invite you to reach out your hand to those around you. Don't let anybody stand alone, but let us be connected. Let us be the body of Christ in this place. And as you go from this place, may the love of God, the grace and peace of Jesus the Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love, now and forever. Amen. Amen.